colleagues. Lions and lionesses, I'll call them. I don't know whether it's a convention. Thank you very much, first of all, for this invitation to speak to you all. As you know, I'm a novice in this Zoom meetings. I have been a lecturer for last umpteen years, I don't know, 40, 45. Quite used to stand up and talk, move around, sitting on the table, bang at me. But now I'm just sitting and looking at a camera. Okay. Having said that, again, thanking you. You have given me a topic. Already the president has very clearly said. I would like to be as brief as possible because this is a very major items you have included, saying about not only the history of Muslims, but also their role on integration and how we can improve on the national relations. Let me be brief. Firstly, I would like to outline a brief history of the Muslims in this country. I know some of my Muslim colleagues will be listening to that. They know much more than me on this topic about the research on history, which is not my main research. I'm not a historian of the Muslims of Sri Lanka, but I have done a lot of archival research on the one part of the Muslim community. Now, let me see, you know, who are the Muslims? When you say Muslims, we are talking about several ethnicities in Sri Lanka. Namely, say the first group, the major preponderant group will be the Sri Lankan Moors. Then comes Sri Lankan Malays. Then you have got other groups like Boras and Maimans. When you talk about Sri Lankan Muslims, we are talking about all these people put together. Having said that, the mostly the Tamil-speaking Moors, they constitute about 95% of the Muslim population in this country. The Sri Lankan Muslims themselves, I think the current population somewhere around 9 to 10, and they are altogether they are about 1.2 million Muslims in this country. And they are of course significant minority next to the Tamils. Now, when did the Muslim settle in this country? Well, the history goes back very much earlier. As we know, the Islam propagated by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Arabian Peninsula since the mid 7th century. There seems to be some records in the Arabic annals, like Al-Baluduri's annals, that the Arabian Peninsula people and Prophet Muhammad and his followers knew about Sri Lanka. And in fact, this Singhala king, Agrabodhi III, was specifically mentioned in some of these Arabic records. It indicates that from 7th century onwards, there were kind of connections between the Arabian Peninsula, Persia, and Sri Lanka. But as you know, that Islam slowly spread, mostly on the Levant, in the Middle East. It took some time for them to reach the subcontinent. However, as you all know, that Arabs were seafarers, Arabs and merchants from Yemen and Yathrib and other places. They reached through monsoonal paths to Sri Lanka in the Mabar and Malabar area. Mabar mean on the east coast of, west coast of India, where you get all these Malabar cities are there, like Cochin, Trivandrum, etc. And all on the other side, Malabar, the Tamil-speaking area, where the Pandyas and Cholas were having their kingdoms. So during the process of this trade, the Arab traders came to mostly South India, and they need to go to places in Southeast Asia, say passing the Indian Ocean, and they went up to Aceh and Indonesia. And during the process, from say 13th century onwards especially, along with the trade, Islam as a religion came to be established. So the historians of Southeast Asia would suggest that they had found an early inscription of the 11th century at Terengganu, the northern Malaya, as the first indication of the presence of Islam. I suppose the same thing can be said of Sri Lanka too, because whoever passed to Southeast Asia, say Aceh and Malacca, etc., they had to pass through Lakshadweep, Maldives, and Sri Lanka. And in the process, Islam became a very strong factor. Why Islam became a factor? Because Sri Lanka was a Buddhist country, very strong Buddhist country at the time, after Anuradhapura period, Polonnaruwa kingdom started on the Parakrama Bahu, the first and the second. But Muslims, traders, at that stage did not penetrate deep into the Rajarata civilization, but they were doing mostly trade in the coastal area. I believe demographically, the Sinhalese civilization was concentrating in the Rajarata civilization, and the coastal areas like Colombo, Matra, Gaul, etc., were, I believe, not so populated. Even if population was there, the kind of activity the coastal cities would have was not up to the indigenous population, I mean the Sinhalese. This vacuum was taken over by the foreign traders. And this is not a phenomena only in Sri Lanka. This happened in Malacca. This happened in Aceh, meaning that foreign traders were preponderantly involved in the both the sea trade and collection of the local products from in the country. The same thing happened in Sri Lanka as well. So what happened, it was not the simple trade. It's a kind of contribution towards a state formation. This is the process in which the Islam as a religion spread in the region, say Maldives, Sri Lanka, Indonesia, Malaysia. Some would argue, some serious extremists would argue, oh, Muslims have killed, make Buddhism to disappear. They went and captured the Buddhist countries, but which is really not true, in a sense that you cannot bring the contemporary historical hatred and beliefs past. What really happened was the presence of the Arabs in the coastal cities was almost like an inspiration to the local population. For example, let me take the question of celibacy. There, the people were not as civilized as Sri Lankan Sinhalese. Similarly, you can say in Aceh, but the conduct and behavior of the Arabs, especially the Sufi mean mystical leaders who accompanied them into these areas, attracted the not so sophisticated local population. The same thing happened to the spread of Brahmanism and Buddhism and Jainism in Sri Lanka. The religion came here partly with the traders of the Brahmins and other people who traded. The same pattern, a Brahmanization pattern, took about Arabization. So what I would suggest to you is, one of the reasons Islam took hold and rooted in this country because of the exemplary behavior of the new arrivals, who for some reason was very much venerated by the local population. Because they had a religion to follow, they used to pray in front of them, and their personal behavior, especially mystical behavior, attracted quite a number of local population. And I have got evidence to show that quite a number of Sinhalese at that time had been attracted to this religion. Along with that, the Arabs also, before they come into Sri Lanka, also settled in South India, both in Malabar and Malabar coast. I mean, the west coast and east coast, where they married the local women, especially Tamil women. Some of them are of low caste. They all were ready to convert to Islam because under their system, they are not treated equally. So having married for one century or so, they left a big progeny. In the western part of India, they are called Mapillas. In Tamil part of India, they are called Chuliyas. Chuliyas are the Tamil-speaking Muslims. Mapillas are the Malayalam-speaking Muslims. And their descendants too arrived in Sri Lanka. So if you talk about Sri Lankan Muslim or Moorish population, I'll come to that, is a mixture of Arabs, partly Persians, and some Mapillas, and this so-called Chuliyas. Their progeny came, and on top of it, the local Sinhalese also joined this community. So that is how the early foundations of Islam started. I don't want to go too deep into the history. Now, when there were some ethnic issues emerged among the extreme Sinhalese, and when these Aludgama riots started, as soon as I came to this country, my colleagues who knew that I'm a historian wanted me to emphasize and write to demonstrate the antiquity of the Muslims, meaning that I was asked to prove that Muslims came very much earlier, say go back to 7th, 8th century. I said, this is a futile exercise. It doesn't matter. Of course, we know historically, a large number of Muslims started settling in the post 10th century period. I don't need to take anything further than that. Actually, in the Sri Lankan historiography, this has become an issue. Take the Tamil history. The Tamil historians, some of them, would like to argue that the Tamils have settled in this country long before the Sinhalese. For example, the so-called Yaksyas and Nagyas you are talking were the Tamil Dravidians. That is the argument that created a little bit of furor in the Sri Lankan parliament recently. I think to me, to prove the antiquity of the races is a futile exercise. All what we have to now understand, these Muslims and Tamils are newcomers. They were there for centuries, say for 10 centuries. In the case of Tamils, say 20 centuries. That makes them kind of Bhumiputras of this country, meaning they are also indigenous to the country. You cannot separate them by the timeline. So having said that, I would like to say the Muslim people, I'm talking largely the Tamil speaking Muslim, I'll come to the point of Tamil speaking Muslims. They were as indigenous as the Sinhalese people. For that matter. So let us stop there. I don't want to go into so many historical arguments to prove that point. Just make sure that Muslims had been living in this country for more than say 10 to 12 centuries. So what? But the most important thing is, how did they became integrated with the so-called national Sri Lankan society? Well, as you know, for some reason, the Muslims, they belong to, or they are followers of Al-Quran, the God's word, and the Hadith of Prophet Muhammad. So this is the two basic foundations of Islam. And when they came, they treated themselves as Ahlul Kitab, meaning people of books. In that case, they continued the tradition of the Torah of the Jews and the Christian Bible. And the Islam is the last religion. So they were the people of the Muslim, the Kitab. And they treated the local population not as people of books. So there was a kind of psychological, internal, religious separatism started existed. For example, Buddhism, for them, is not a religion of the book. And they considered it as an iconoclastic, meaning that, as Buddhism and Hinduism, we have so many gods, especially with the emergence of Mahayana. The Buddha, Lord Buddha himself, was turned into a godly image following the Kushan influence in India. We know about that, the question of Mahayana and Hinayana, Theravada versus Mahayana. So Buddha, ordinary mystic or a great leader, was turned himself into a god. But that is the kind of distinction this was made between the local, if I call so-called the what you call Buddhist and Sinhala population, and the book following Islamic population. And therefore, there was a reason that they separated themselves, their racial, what you call integrity, through a separate identity of language. And that language was both Arabic and Tamil. That is how the early Arab, the Muslims of Sri Lanka, became Tamil speakers. Because for them, they needed to establish the identity vis-a-vis the Sinhalese iconoclastic, what you call, God-worshipping Buddhist. So let me say that. I hope I'm not making any controversial statement, but it's a fact. So the Sri Lankan Moorish history is very much interlinked with the what you call Tamil language, and their religious text came to be written in Tamil, and the religions were taught in Tamil. And they also developed, therefore, a new type of hybrid language called Arabic Tamil, Arab Tamil, in which their religion was propagated. So that is why you don't get any singular text, singular Islamic text of the early period. When I mean early period, say 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th century, you will not have until very recently. Even the Quran singular translation was conducted, I think, within last 10, 15 years in this country. So you see, you have to understand that aspect of the Muslims. So now I'm talking about Tamil-speaking Moors. Why they are Moors, they call it. In fact, in the Sinhala literature, they are called Yonaka. Yonaka coming from the Greek word Ionian, Yavana. Yavana, and become Yonaka. And the British, when they came here, they identified groups for their statistical purposes. That is where even the Malay was introduced as a terminology. Vedas were introduced. Similarly, they introduced the term Moors. But of course, the Moors was in practice even during the what you call Portuguese period. So they were known to be Moors of Sri Lanka. And until recently, say 1980s, the Moors birth certificates showed them as Sri Lanka Marakkalaya, not Ceylon Marakkalaya. But later, some responsible officer changed into a Moors. And the Moors became another identity marker in the recent past. In fact, I was talking about the Tamil language, relations between Tamil language and Islam and Muslims. So much so, Sir Ponnambalam Ramanathan once declared that the Muslims are Tamils, which created a great furor among the Muslim community. And one guy wrote a book, Ethnology of Sri Lanka Muslims, in which he clearly argued, we are not Tamils. We are Tamil speakers. So, see, that is the beginning of the identity issues. Now, we're coming to briefly about the Malays. They are also Muslims. The Malays reached this country largely during the Portuguese and Dutch period, mostly Dutch period. And they came from all over Indonesia. They are originally known as Oosterlingen. Oosterlingen means Easterners. But there is a story that actually the Malays proper, who come from Malayan part, the Northern Malaysia, were the original founders of Jaffna Kingdom. How? This Maga, who came to this country to rob Lord Buddha's Pikshapatra, the begging bowl, he came all the way from Tamralinga, a place called Nakhon Sri Thammarat in 1236, which is mentioned in the Chulavamsa. They say, Chulavamsa say the terrible Javakas came with the arrows, destroyed to get our Lord's Patra. So the Malays came to rob. I don't want to create another ethnic riots in this country. But what happened was, those guys were expelled by Dishanka Malla from Polonnaruwa, and they went to the north. Then they established this Java Patuna. You see, Java Patuna, for example, as Parnavithana, or great Parnavithana, divided this country into three pitaka, Java Patuna, Ruhuna, and the other one. So It's called Java Patuna. Was becoming Jaffna, Japana, Yalpana. The Tamil historians turned this into a kind of lit, saying that the Jaffna was founded by a man who played one of the instrument, Yal. But the technically, what's happened is there is a proof to say that the original Malay, I would call Malay those time, Northern Malay, the so-called Maga and his son was setting up themselves in Jaffna. And what happened was, one of the guys, the Java son, had for fighting with the Pandyan king at that time. And that Pandyan king left an inscription. This is a real story. He said, "Nan Javagan Maindanai Kondre." I beheaded the son of Java. Can you believe that? And that guy came from Jaffna. In fact, this is highlighted in my book, Jaffna Kingdom. I was told that late Prabhakaran was looking for me to kill. My God, I'm a great and explosive historian. Anyway, why I'm mentioning this, this history myth and also very much mixed in this country. So now I'm coming to the second element of Muslims. The third one is, of course, minority, Boras and Maimans. They are what we call settler community. They are merchant communities. They came largely from Gujarat. So, but when I'm talking about Muslims in this country, please remember, we are talking largely about the Moors and to some extent, Malays. Now, that is a part of history. Now, I'm coming to the second part. Now, as you know, the Muslims are not there in numbers in the Rajarata period, meaning they were not there in the Anuradhapura, they were not in the Polonnaruwa period. And as you know, in historically, from 13th century onwards, there was a shift of demographic population and culture from Rajarata to the wetlands. Wetlands, meaning the new kingdom started emerging, like, say, Dambadani Rajadhania, Yappahuwa, Kote, Sitavaka, and finally, of course, Kandy. Now, the Muslims you're talking about are now beginning to be associated with this so-called Singhala kingdoms like Yappahuwa, Kurunagala, Dambadaniya, and of course, Kote, Sitavaka. You know, what was the role of the Muslims at the time? In fact, that was the best period, the golden period of Singhala-Muslim relations. They had a symbiotic relationship with the Sinhalese people. I don't want to go into such details. What happened was the Muslims acted as the ministers of the Sinhala kings, rulers. How I will tell you. You know, the Sinhala rulers needed funds to enrich their palaces and kings, and they do trade. And the trade was in the hands of them, I told you, the Muslim traders. And the Muslim traders could easily converse with the Indians. And that's how the Muslim traders became the official translators of the Sinhala kings. And they carried their missais mean letters. I have got evidence of Arab Tamil letter written by a Kandyan king to the Cochin Maharaja. And who did it? The Sri Lankan Muslims at that time. And that is why I will call Muslims had always been the foreign ministers of the Sinhala rulers. Not only that, they have played all other roles. Like, for example, they were very good, great Yunani doctors. And the Sinhalese king, along with Ayurveda, they like indigenous medicine, they invited the Muslim doctors, Yunani doctors, and they were treating the Sinhala rulers. This is recorded in history. Third, Muslims were the interior ministers. For example, they supplied whatever the palace needed, most importantly, the elephants. One of the important elephant catching groups were the Muslim groups. In fact, Muslims have awarded elephants to the Darda Maliga. And it is recorded in one of our currency note. There's a Muslim man with the elephant and carrying like a. Then fourth, the Muslims have been doing a lot of service into the temples. They became the palanquin bearers. They carry carts and they participated wholeheartedly, and they donated much to the functioning of the local festivals. I'm not telling this. Lona Devaraja, a Sinhalese historian, very respected historian, my teacher, she wrote a very beautiful book called The Kandyan Kingdom, The Muslims in the Kandyan Kingdom. She highlighted and delineated all these details about the symbiotic, or what you call the interrelationship that existed between the Sinhalese and the Muslims in all angles. And mind you, at that time, you look at that literature of the period, Sandesiyas, Koyila Sandesiya, Selalini Sandesiya. There are good words about the Muslims. Hardly any animosity, hardly any distinction was made. Muslims, in other words, was very well respected by the indigenous rulers. So much so, when the Dutch and the Portuguese arrived, the tables changed. The Muslims could not continue as they did in the past, have a free trade, free movement under the Portuguese and Dutch, because Portuguese came with two purposes. They came for trade and they came for conversion. So they're strong Catholics. They came with the purpose to proselytize these people. And they found Muslims were their number one enemies to penetrate the Sinhala society or the Buddhist society. And therefore, they introduced all kinds of impediments prosecuting Muslim traders and Muslim settlers. What happened? Therefore, who came to their rescue? It was the Sinhalese again. The Sinhalese rulers, like Senarat Dasu, they found areas where Muslims can pursue their trade, religion, and their agriculture and fisheries on their own. And therefore, they can become suppliers of these goods to the interior Sinhalese people. So they were traders, basically. That's how the trade started coming. And they got into the jamming. So that is how Muslims, after the Portuguese and Dutch, they could survive solely because of the support and cooperation provided no less than the Sinhalese rulers. So again, I'm coming to a point, historically, there was hardly any kind of animosity, which we now find at that period. So this is a fantastic history. I think my time is running out. Now I'm coming to some major issues. I have got a lot of notes here to write about, the Muslims clan were domiciled in Getab area in the Kegal district, claimed descent from Arab physicians, Hakims, who arrived in the country from Sindh during the reign of King Parakmubao II of Dambadeniya, and espoused Kandyan women, the Muslims of Sri Lanka, 1,000 years of ethnic harmony. James Emerson Tennant mentions in his monumental work, Ceylon, that in the mountains of Udakinde in Western Uva province, in a small community known as the Paduguruvas, who profess Islam, but conform to Kandyan customs. While H.W. Codrington gives Guruva as a man of mixed race of Sinhalese and Moor descent and of the Mohammedan religion in Uva. The Guruo are also said to have been found in Diburuavela in the Udasiya Pattu of Matale South. Less known is the fact that this intermarriage between Muslim and Sinhalese was also in evidence in the South and is known to have continued until fairly recent times. Denham observes, Denham in E.B. Denham in 1911 in his statistics, that amongst the most of Colombo and Gaul at the present day, there must be a fairly considerable infusion of Sinhala blood. The number of Sinhalese women married to or living with Moors is fairly large. In fact, the Muslims of the Sinhalese areas have tended to bear a certain resemblance to the Sinhalese among whom they live, which may perhaps indicate some admixture of Sinhalese blood since at least the Kandyan period. So you see, I'm talking about a much larger picture. Now, in the context of that, after the Portuguese and Dutch, Muslims of Sri Lanka suffered in the sense they were prosecuted. Then now coming to the, because of the time factor, I don't want to go into the history of the Muslims during the two early colonial period, which you know the relations between them. Then you come to the British. During the British period, Muslims began thriving again, meaning that there was no such active persecution of the Muslims. They started returning quietly to areas around Gaul, especially in Colombo and all. Even before they started, but under the British, they could reassert themselves. And they got into the trade, but only the problem with the Muslims was, they were afraid after the Portuguese and Dutch to expose their children to Christianity. Because they are very ardent believers on their religion. They were not ready to convert themselves. So therefore, they avoided any areas where the children could be converted. What is the area we are talking about conversion? Is the school system. The Dutch diocese schools and the schools were used to proselytize people. That is how the Tamil population in the north, they did not mind getting proselytized. They studied in the Dutch state schools and like Vattukote areas, all the methodical schools and Catholic schools, they were ready to go, but not the Muslims. So therefore, they lost the bus. In other words, during the late British period even, the Muslims were not an elite or educated society as such. But what happened? Even the practice of their religion was dwindling. After the persecution of the Dutch and the British, the Dutch and the Portuguese. And then what happened from India? India, the special people came here to establish madrasas. One of them called Mapillai Alim Sahib. They came from the Kilakari, where the original Arab settled down. He came here to revive Islam among these people. And he's the one who started some schools solely to teach them the religion, I will call religion. Say, for example, how to do ablution, how to pray, how to bury their dead, etc., etc. So he established, we call Quran schools, Quran Pallikoodam, which became a norm in those periods. So Muslims were naturally did not go into the secular education, I mean English education, so that they can become professionals. They preferred to remain doing trading and fishing and agriculture, but not the modern education. That's how they lost out. So only in the late 19th century, when the revivalist movement started in Sri Lanka, there was some interest in English education. There's a special man came from exiled called Arabi Pasha. Arabi Pasha was exiled from Egypt here. And he, along with Siddilebbe, a lawyer, and all this group, they thought the Muslims are lagging behind. Therefore, they are the one who started laying a new system for modern education. I call modern education. That's how the later schools like Zahira College emerged. That's another story. So in other words, my argument is the Muslim education proper was lost out and started the modern education much later. That's why you don't get much of a Muslim professionals. But Malays, different story. They were in the military regiment run by the British. They ran a special schools to the Malays to make them cadets. They were in the Slave Island area and Kandy, Bogambar area. There were special schools to teach Malay children, English, 3 hours, arithmetic, and their language. And they were the elites to some extent. They were closer to corridors of power than the large majority of the Tamil-speaking Muslims. That is a very interesting story that has to be explored again. So therefore, this is what happened to the British period. And then you come closer to the 21st century. As far as I see, the first problems emerged in the late 19th century with Anagarika Dharmapala. In Anagarika Dharmapala's writings, there's a lot of animosity, angry towards Muslims living. But which Muslim? This is the important thing. There was a group of Muslims, especially from Tamil Nadu, South India, they came here to do trade. They became ubiquitous traders in everywhere. Badulla, name them. Gal, Matra, everywhere, they had their shops, small shops. They used to do trade. And they say these people exploit. They have a sort of black, what do you call it? The black marketeers, if you can call it. And the Sinhalese villagers, they simply loathe these people. So they are called coast mosques. Real name called Hambankarya. They are called coast mosques. So there was a lot of resentment against this coast mosque. And as a result, again, a major event that took place in Sri Lankan history, that is in 1915, anti-Muslim riots. They started in, I think, Kendi, near Darda Maligawa, in that Mairamaka mosque. Some Muslims came out and Sinhalese procession came and they started Rabana or something. That triggered the local this thing and it spread out. And quite a number of Karawa leaders, like D'Souza's, finally was caught and British prosecuted them and some were hanged for their role in creating mayhem. And that's how Sir Ponnambalam Ramanathan, etc., they took the Sinhalese side and argued their case in the Privy Council in England. So this is the 1915 riot, was the first ever major problem that occurred between the Sinhalese and the Muslims. But that was, again, I would argue, not because of the indigenous Muslims, that's also because of the Muslims who came recently. Okay, now let me finish that. Now you come to the modern period. In say 1950s, 30s, we started with the Legislative Council. There were several commissions, Donmore Commission, before that Salisbury Commission, the constitutions came up. Still no issues. The Muslims were given representation. They didn't mind. We got under the British Constitution, Salisbury Constitution, we created national-minded leaders. The best example is Tuan Burhanuddin Jaya, T.B. Jaya, the founder of Zaire College and one of the greatest leader, not the Malay leader only, Muslim leader. He was the symbolical of Muslim-Sinhala relation. He worked very close with the, what you call, leaders, freedom, independent leaders, especially D.S. Sainaika. And he was one of the founder of the United National Party. And he was a very much respected leader. He became a labor minister, a great guy. Today, even T.B. Jaya is very much remembered. Then followed other leaders too. Look at we know recently, Muhammad Hanifa Muhammad, M.H. Muhammad. Look at Dr. Khalil. And the best example will be Sinhala Marikar. He's called Sinhala Marikar because he speaks Sinhala. Then what happened? People like Badiuddin Mahmud, we talked about it. Dr. Khalil. Then Bakir Makar. All these guys had a very specific, an Asia Summit. All these are great Muslim leaders who worked closely with the Buddhist leaders and with the, what do you call, the Sinhala leaders. They were accepted, and they had a clout. If anything goes wrong with the Muslims, if the Muslims don't have, say, they can just walk to Bandaranaika, they can go to D.S. Sainaika, they can go to Dudley Sainaika, and they can ask, and out of respect, they gave the concessions to them. This was how it was. Their words were as gold as their word, and they were very accepted national leaders. So this is the exemplary leadership Sri Lankan Muslims had. Sir Razik Farid, no problem whatsoever. Of course, there are a few issues they may hear and crop up, but there is no national sentiments. So what happened after that? Now we are coming to politics. Now we come with the JR government is introduced so-called open economy. You know, the open economy means, everybody knows, it really brought certain prosperity to the country, changed all the socialist concept. It brought money, like in Malaysia. Malaysia came up because of the money for the indigenous people, Mahathir Mohamad opened up with a new economic policy. So JR did it, but along with the prosperity came the political struggle, political power. The economic power became associated with the political power. And when political power is getting mixed up with economic power, it entails other things like greed, corruption, and cheating, building up what you call wealth for oneself and also seven generations, which we see in Sri Lanka. So Sri Lanka was becoming in the grip of this economic so-called opening, but at the same time, economic downfall, which you are witnessing today. Then in order to manipulate the entire constitution, the new constitution started, 1972 constitution. Then they brought the district council. Then they brought proportional representation, etc., etc. And what happened was, the very method by which they wanted to keep the certain minorities contained, the minorities could work within the system to emerge. In other words, minorities, I'm talking about Muslim minority, started demanding political power, which is one of the problems which we are facing today. If I have time, I want to just briefly explain to you my living in Malaysia. I was teaching a course on the politics and economics of Malaysia. I discovered one thing. In Brunei and Malaysia, they had a significant Chinese population, significant, including, of course, Singapore is a different cup of tea, including Indonesia. You know, there is a comparison between these three countries. These Chinese minorities, they contain themselves by doing their business. They didn't want to disturb anybody else. In fact, in Brunei, they were the richest people in Brunei. And you know what they tried to do? At one point, they tried to start a party, political party. But some wise man said, please, don't start political party. Leave the politics to the locals, meaning Malays. We do our business. And they are still successful. No problem. Similarly, Malaysia. Malaysia, in the 1945, the British tried to do a dirty tricks. They wanted to give equal rights to the newly arrived Chinese. They say Chinese people, 25, 30 population, they did to 30 member of parliament. They did try to do to the Tamils who were recently settled there. And that really disturbed the Malay population. And the famous United Malay National Organization, which is still ruling Malaysia. Yesterday also there was a crisis. That United Malay National Organization emerged to restrain the minorities gaining political power. They also said it, you do your business, anything, we are supporting you, but don't come and pucker around with our system, our indigenous system. But what happened in Sri Lanka was, fortunately, unfortunately, with the emergence of the Muslim Congress, the race for snatching power started. And you know the outcome of it. The race for snatching power is not to bring upliftment of the Muslims as such. Sometime, like the other majority single leaders or corrupt leaders, the Muslim also can be corrupt. And that is the perception the Sinhalese will have about the Muslim. You fellows, you use our system, you parliament. Let me openly say about what happened to Mr. Rishad Badudi. He became a symbol of hatred. He was asked to, the whole government in front, they tried to sack him. They tried to bring a no confidence motion. And mind you, he could hold so many portfolios in his hand, including Minister of Trade. That really upset. I mean, I'm not arguing he's right or the Sinhalese leaders were not right. But the fact is that when a minority person tried to, what you call, arrogate powers, just because he's holding voter base, he's not going to issue the thing. And even today, that is festering in this country. And I will argue, therefore, the outbreak of the violence at Alutgama, followed in Digana, were all manifestations of this. It's not the fault of the Muslims either. What happened under the new system, the political corrupt system, Sri Lankan politics was becoming synonymous with ethnicity. In other words, ethno-Buddhist religion. And you see the emergence of new groups like Bodubalasena, Singhala Ravaya. They are constantly barraging and attacking. After the 2009 defeat of the Tamil LTT, the entire, what you call the hatred, or what you call the common enemy, spoiling the mind of the Buddhist, preaching to them, and on top of it, the public media in Sri Lanka, unrestrained public media, I'll name it, other than it, and Hiru TV, they were 100% going against the Muslims. Why? They were trying to Kadayanava. What Kadayanava? for the people who will give political power. You scratch my back, I scratch my back. That's what they're doing. So you see, that is how the Muslim status became down. Unlike M.H. Muhammad period, unlike Bakir Makkah period, now what happened is the Muslim leaders are not taken seriously. On top of it, these guys, within the political party, they are not voting in one unison to have their power. That is why the Muslim Congress was set up. Let us have together. And therefore, we will bargain. That bargaining power is gone. They're eating each other in the community. So it is a different story. So what I'm telling you is, I want to conclude. The last part, I became political. I'm comparing the status in Malaysia. Malaysia, there was a major riot in 1969 among the Sinhalese, Chinese and the Malays, but that is it, contained. They know where the roots are, right? But Sri Lanka has to learn. Now I'm going to conclude my talk. Now, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? But I'm telling you, my dear friends, that the Sri Lanka will never go forward only based on one ethno-religious power. You need to accommodate the Muslims, for that matter, even Tamils, into the state system, economic system. And you know the amount of people now migrated after the 1983 riots, lot of Tamil brains drained. All the top brains are abroad. Even the Muslims now, quite a number of Muslims taking their money and going back to Malaysia. I mean, even you're losing funds, you're losing people, you're losing brain. Is that what you want? Can we do it? So therefore, I'm telling you, in future, we need to restrain, we need to bring quite a lot of legal reforms, such as defamation laws. Now, anybody can just go and defame a person in the TV without any responsibility. You can't go to courts. I'll tell you a classic example. During the presidential elections of Honorable Gotabaya Rajapaksa, there was a story that H.M. Fauzi, old man, his 80s. He's a sort of gone case that he has been trying to assassinate this president. And I asked this minister, hey, why don't you go to courts, man? This is a great defamation. They can't prove it. No, man. The law, courts, they won't bother. In other words, the court system has come down. So it's very difficult. Have I got time?
Professor, we would like to conclude the session now because we have another couple of questions the audience would like to
ask. Okay, then I'll conclude. So what I'm saying is Sri Lanka take active steps towards national unity and national integration. You cannot do all by yourself. And I'm sure the Muslims will cooperate in that case. They will give up some of their powers in order to work with the majority community. They love the Sinhalese. They love the Tamils. No problem. But I think my final suggestion is history, if you have to be learned, has to be learned from that Yapahua period and Kurunagala period. So I wish a great progress for Sri Lanka. And I'm sure I'm a Muslim, I'm a Sinhalese, and I'm a Sri Lanka. In fact, I'm married to a Sinhalese girl. You may be surprised, your president, Asita, is my nephew. He didn't tell that. His mother is my brother's sister-in-law. See the connections we're having. Now it will explain to you. So this country is a wonderful country. There's no division. So if all of us can live like that together, we can bring a great, prosperous Sri Lanka. Thank you very much. I'm willing to answer your questions.
Thank you very much, Professor. I think that was, very insightful. So in fact, the Lions Club of Colombo host, we have been serving the nation for the past more than 62 years. And our motto goes as, we serve, same as you intended. And also for this year, our club theme is, shared prosperity through inclusion, where, as a club, we always try to promote, equality and governance, transparency, and inclusiveness. So that's why, we have planned to have a series of, sessions like this, of this nature, to educate the general public, Sri Lankans as a country, and to bring that inclusiveness to this country so that, we can move forward as a country. So I would like to, with that remark, I would like to move on to questions. So for the interest of time, I would pick about three questions. So Professor, the first question to you is, please pardon me if I don't pronounce his name correctly. If Ahlul Kitab concept is the reason why more Muslims didn't mix more with Sinhalese, then what is the reason for Malay Muslims to live in more closely with Sinhalese? Was the question clear to you, Professor?
Very clear. Can I answer now?
Yes, please. Please.
Yeah, first question is correct. Ahlul Kitab mean they were people of books, meaning they were monotheist. You have to understand the difference between monotheism and the iconoclastism, worshipping of gods. So these are two different things. So that is why the Muslim themselves could not integrate it with the Sinhala Buddhism as such. But as far as Malays, you are suggesting that they were close to Sinhalese, which is not true. I'll tell you why. The Malays lived in cantonments in Bogambara, Slave Island, Kurunagala, everywhere around the Muslim population. The early literature, Malay literature, is three kinds, Urdu and Tamil, Arabic Tamil and Arabic. They did not write in Sinhalese. So only in the recent past, say within last 20, 30 years, there's a lot of admixture between the Malays and the Muslims with the Sinhalese. There are a lot of intermarriages taking place. At that one time, most of the intermarriages between Malays took place with the Moorish. But now, because they're working in the population, say, for example, they're working in the, what you call, officers, there are a lot of romances emerging and there's no breakdown. And the Malays are not that orthodox, strict Muslims in the sense of like Moors. They can accommodate things. So to answer your second question, it is not true that Malays were with the Sinhalese and the Moors were not with the Sinhalese. Both were the same, but except in the recent past, the barriers, national barriers are breaking down. And even among the Moors, they are now taking on more and more to Sinhalese as a language. Until very recently, the Muslims could not speak very fluent Sinhalese. Now you see emerging. We are reporters, Sinhala speakers, like Bakir Maka San, Imtiaz Bakir Maka. It's a Sinhalese orator. It's a new class of people are emerging. So that is the effect of the recent past, not to the past. I'm talking, make a distinction between the past and the recent, earlier past, colonial past, and the recent past. The recent past is not an indication of what happened in history.
Thank you, Professor. So I would like to move on to the next question. So next question is, the incoming Muslims were predominantly Sunnis. Were there interreligious rivalry when the Shias arrived in Sri Lanka?
I would say, you're right, because mostly Shias came from the Iranian area, Persian area. They were Shias, they were Sunnis. Even Sri Lanka, I will say 95% were the Sunnis. There were very little, few Shias, but the Shia culture somehow or other penetrated the Sunni culture. And Sri Lanka, they're practicing it. In fact, I am born during this month. This is a very holy month for the Shias, Muharram. This is a Muslim month when Prophet Muhammad's grandson was massacred in Karbala. And then a new sect started with Prophet's nephew, Ali. And that is how the Shia started. And I am born in this month, and that's why I'm named Hussein by my mother. So you see the Shia influence. But as you asked me, there was hardly any Shia-Sunni conflict in Sri Lanka, because all these are Sunni Muslims you see in Sri Lanka. Plus, they all belong to one sect called Shafi. You know, Islam, we have four sects. Shafi, Hanafi, Hanbali, etc. So Sri Lankan Muslims, like the South Asian Muslims, Southeast Asian Muslims, they're mostly Sunnis and Shafis. And that's why they can connect with the Southern Arabian Peninsula. Am I right? I think I gave you explanation.
Yes, thank you, Professor. And so I think we'll move on to the final question. Okay, so the final question is, the internal harmony between the Muslims and the Sinhalese was always generally prevalent. There is a school of thought that with the advent of travel, the Muslims went to the ME for employment. I guess that represents Middle East for employment. And along with that move, they also started following certain practices associated with Arabs, like the clothing and face covering. Also, maybe consciously moving along among Muslims. Without explaining the change in habits, customs and appearances, the Muslims expected the majority to accept this change in the Muslim persona. May I add that this was also the migration of Muslims from the east to Colombo. Colombo Muslims too started changing. Your thoughts? I know, sorry about the lengthy question, but I think
no, the good question, because I was meaning to touch upon the so-called extremism, fundamentalism in Sri Lanka, which is must have been topic. We did not touch about that famous incident of Easter bombing. What happened? This is all your question is related to that. Actually, certain changes have taken place. This is what we call Arabization. And South Asian Muslims and even Malaysians are very worried about the Arabization. With the emergence of the petrodollars, Arabia, Saudi Arabia, and even Iran, they started treating Islam as an ideology and started converting people, Muslim people, into making them pure Muslims as if they lived in Arabia. In fact, I forgot to tell you, when you talk about Islam, there is a two way of living for Muslims. They live in, we call Darul Harb, the warring states, or Darul Islam, that is Islamic states. When you talk Islamic state, Libya, homogeneous Muslims, Pakistan, mostly, Arabia, and you Qatar, all these are Muslim countries. The living of the Muslims there is quite different from the Muslim living in the minority countries, like in India and Sri Lanka. And don't treat Muslims as a very homogeneous people of life. The problem was that some extremists, some fundamentalists we call it, started preaching the same type of Darul Islam type of religion into the minorities here. I, along with other people, are very much against this. We don't want to accept the living style. For example, they started interpreting Al-Quran and the Hadith in a very strictest way. Not everybody. It's a very minute part of population, one person. And that's why we call them extremists, fundamentalists. And those guys, like in any community, can play havoc. That's what happened in Sri Lanka. That small minority of the guys, seven guys who went and killed themselves, bombed themselves, were contributing to this feeling. But don't think that 99.9% of the Muslims in this country ever subscribe to such ideas. They are very aware that they are living in a minority country and they have to make adjustments to live, how to live with the majority people, particularly Sinhala Buddhists, which they're learning to do it. You are right. The recent emergence of the Middle East money, people going to the Middle East, coming back with their dress code, etc., have certainly created a kind of revulsion among the majority people. What are these girls are now wearing blacks as if they're in Arabia? They're asking that question, rightly so. I mean, they can cover decently. Now, if you go to Malaysia, the people dresses nice, decent dress, have a sarong, kabaya. They cover it themselves and put a nice head cover. It's a very, very pretty sight. But whereas in Sri Lanka, they got misguided and these guys loaded money in the organization and they started wearing the Arab dress, the black dress. So I think some of the Muslims may not like what I'm trying to say. What I'm saying is Islam prescribed the dress code as to cover your awrat. Awrat means anything that's exposed, attractive. It doesn't matter, but it doesn't need to be a cultural dress of somebody else. In Sri Lanka, they're wearing like North Indians, like salwar and kameez. You have seen Sinhalese girls are wearing. I mean, that's okay. Muslim women are wearing saris. That is equally respectable. That covers all part of body with covering. So why not? So you are perfectly correct. My point is, the Sri Lankan Muslims are becoming increasingly aware to maintain their traditional lifestyle and behave as they are. You don't need to contribute themselves to an Arabization or Iranization process. They will resist it. But you can't avoid. There is always a group of people, like in your Sinhalese society. Take Bodhubala Sena, take Singhala Rave. They're extremely people. In fact, the recent, what you call commission, even asked them to proscribe this organization. So that is, this is nothing exclusive to Muslims. Even among Christians, I will say, Tamils, of course, you saw how extremist few people hijacked the entire community, and the entire community is paying the price for it. So therefore, President, I will try to argue that don't try to marginalize or giving a certain color to the entire community because of the behavior and thought process of few people, which they will be always in a community. This is very common. I think I answered you correctly.
Yes, Professor. So I think not only the last question, your entire session was very refreshing and insightful. So thank you very much for that. So anyway, to formally thank you, I would like to invite our club secretary, Lion Dr. Mahen Vimaladharma. Mahen?
Yes. On behalf of the Lions Club of Colombo host, we'd like to extend our sincere appreciation, Professor Hussain Mia, for accepting our invitation and giving us this very interesting talk on the Sri Lankan Muslims, their history and contribution towards an integrated nation. I was very pleased to know how you touched upon from the very beginning to the current situation we are all facing. And we learned a lot of things in history, which we have heard from various sources, but you put it all together in a very nice way. And also how I feel from the Portuguese time to the current politicians who try to bring that rift between the various people and the races, religions in Sri Lanka. So I'm glad you touched up on many aspects. And what I feel is we as a nation, we as people of all ethnicities, we need to work towards together. And as, like Asita said, that's the message we try to bring from our Lions Club as well, and as Lions as a whole, to that we need to keep sure we don't get fooled by people and politicians who try to influence the change of or the course of history. But someone like you who has really studied the depth of history, you know, it's really welcoming that we are brought, given the knowledge to realize that we shouldn't be fooled and how we can make things better and move forward as one united nation. So thank you very much. We truly appreciate it. And I also like to thank all the participants here who are here with us today. So other than our Lions members, we have a lot of guests who are here. So we truly appreciate all of you being here. And thank you very much. And wish you all a pleasant night and stay safe in these troubled times. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mahen.
Thank you,
Professor.
Thank you very much.
Budhu Saranai. How are we closing this now?
We can close it from our end, Professor.
Okay, right. Then I can leave. Thank you
yes,
very much.
Yes, Professor. Thank you very much. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you. Totally
thank you, Professor. Get in touch with you.
Please. Yeah, Mr. Ahmed. Okay, right.